Welcome back to Our Community. Susie Thomas visiting with Bob Phipps, who is Director of Development for Community Hospice. And right before the break, you mentioned that it's not just end of life. You do work with people in prisons and some more unconventional services as well. Let's talk about those.
Yeah. I mean, our banner is we serve wherever the patient might be. Mm-hmm. That means sometimes we get into some unusual locations. We have served people that are in prisons. We've served people in group homes. We had a lady about 3 years ago who was homeless. We served her in our inpatient unit. Wow. And then tried to place her, you know, in a facility, and she would have none of it. Her home was really on the streets, that's where she wanted to be.
Wow.
Regardless of our efforts to try to connect her. But, you know, that kind of stuck with me.
Yeah.
That we sometimes try to impose what we think is right on someone, and this is what they really wanted.
Wow.
So, but yeah, we serve a patient no matter where they might be.
There must be some misconceptions about who you are, what you do. Can you talk about those?
Yeah, I mean, I go back to my beginning in hospice. I had no clue what it was really about until I got involved in the work. One misconception is age. You know, people generally think, well, hospice is for older, and it's true. As we get older and we age, we do come to the end of life. But unfortunately, that's not true for all of our patients. We had a baby about 6 months ago that the parents were told the baby would probably die at the hospital.
Oh, dear.
The child did not. And so the child came home but was still, you know, it was going to end. And we were called in to support that, work with that family. And so we have patients of all ages. We even have a pediatric room at our inpatient facility where we care for a little one if we're called to do that.
That just brings to mind to me that you are not really only ministering to the person who's facing end of life. You also, there are the other patients, if you will, of the family members that are there and caring for what they're going through at the same time.
I think that may be our greatest work. Mm-hmm. Yes, the clinical care for the patient's essential. It's what we do. It has to be high quality. But when I get unsolicited comments when I'm out in public and people know I'm with hospice, usually it's such gratitude for being with them at a really difficult time and helping support them, care for them, and then counsel them. Not only through the death of a loved one, but then our bereavement department, which picks up with that family and offers to them for 13 months either counseling or resources or support groups so that they can, you never really get over the loss of a loved one, but you get through it. And that's our goal, is to help support people so they can get through this time of grieving.
Adjusting to that new normal.
Yeah.
Yeah. There are 28 hospices in Stark County alone. You're one of four nonprofits. Tell me about you and what makes you unique.
Yeah, and I'm always careful. I think, anyone related to any hospice does a wonderful job. We're all trying to care for people at a difficult time.
That's right.
But ours is a nonprofit. That means a number of things. One, it means that our investors are our volunteers. Our investors are the community that support us through fundraising. So no stockholders out there are getting a dividend as a result of us having good business model. Secondly, our board is very local. It's local people that are like you and I. They live in this community, they do business in this community, and they give their time. They don't get paid to be on our board. They give of their time to give us governance and guidance, and that's true of all of our volunteers that volunteer in fundraising as well. Thirdly, we provide care regardless of the ability to pay. So a hospice patient, quite often if they're on Medicare has a hospice benefit. If they're Medicaid, there's a hospice benefit. Most private insurances have a hospice benefit. But we still, even in spite of the new national health care plan, run into patients that don't have insurance.
Certainly.
We still provide the care. We do not charge them. We run into patients recently that do have insurance, but probably everybody at home that's listening, you know, your deductibles are higher.
Yes.
And your co-pays are higher, even if you have insurance now. So by the time a family gets to us, quite often their resources have been totally spent. and they still have the need for hospice care. We provide it. The gap we fill with fundraising dollars.
Well, that was my next question. If a person is not able to pay and yet you're still providing the care, who is paying for it then?
It comes from fundraising. It comes from our donations. It's why I have a job, actually, is to raise that money so that we never turn away anybody for their ability to pay.
Well, let's talk about fundraising. First of all, before we get into events and fundraising events, how can someone donate or contribute or participate with this? Is there a giving button on your website, or what do you suggest?
There's lots of ways. There is a giving button on our website, or they can call us. We promote pretty strongly our fundraising events in each county, and so I'll come back to talking about two that are coming up this year in Stark County. They can get involved that way. We are blessed to get a lot of in lieu of flowers, gifts when someone passes. If they want to remember a loved one, sometimes they'll designate, could you just make a contribution to community hospice?
Yes.
Those are some of the ways.
Those are all good, and that does keep you busy. Well, let's talk about a couple of fundraisers coming up this year.
Sure. We have a traditional one. We've been doing it now for 13 years. This will be our 14th annual Rigatoni Dinner. It is held this year, March 31st. Usually it's in April, but Easter's early this year, everything's early this year.
Yeah.
From 5 to 7:30 at St. Mary's Catholic Church in Massillon.
Okay.
And
right there on Cherry Road, beautiful, beautiful building. I know they're in the middle of rebuilding.
They are. Unfortunately, they had a fire this year, but they know how important this is to us. So they're still allowing our use of their educational building for this fundraiser.
March 31st, what are the times?
From 5 to 7:30. Cost is 10 for adults or 5 for ages 4 to 12, free under age 4. And it's rigatoni, and it's meatballs, and it's sausage, and it's desserts and salad. And
is this all cooked up by Bob Phipps, or where does the food come from?
No, fortunately, it's good food. this is where our volunteers come into play.
Wow, yeah.
It's strictly a volunteer effort. We've got a kitchen crew that has cooked most of those 14 years. We've got a crew that does the outside stuff, making sure there's desserts and salads and all that. So we're very blessed with our volunteers.
Okay, and time again it starts?
5 o'clock
okay.
to 7:30. They can get tickets at the door, or they can call our 800 number and we can get tickets to them.
Okay, and we'll give that again before we leave.
Sure.
Okay, and then you've got something coming up a little bit later once it warms up in August.
Yeah. This is actually our biggest fundraising event of the year. This has been growing. This will be our 7th annual Taste of Heaven. And it's, again, hospice and food seem to connect. And so this is an event that revolves around desserts. And we're fortunate that we get about 10 dessert vendors in this area, the 10 best desserts in Stark County. And they bring that to the event, and then we supplement that with appetizers. And usually people skip the appetizers, go right to the desserts.
That sounds wonderful.
But then we have music, and we have auction items, and we have some other fun things that happen for that evening. August 20th at the Crassas Center, which is just down the street from Malone University. And it's usually from 5:30 to about 9 o'clock.
Sounds wonderful. Okay, and
event.
Again, let's give that 800 number now for more information.
Sure. It's 800-947-7284. Or folks could stop by our Stark office, which is at 4912 Higbee Avenue, Northwest, right across from Belden Village Mall, same building as Ohio Head and Neck is in.
Now, over the last 30 years, you've had a number of different places that you've called home. Talk about the little moves. Where else have you been?
Yeah, in Stark County, we started in Massillon. Then we moved over into the Belden area on Whipple. Then we outgrew that space and went downtown to the Goodwill Community Campus. And then just a year ago, to have a little bit more visibility and be a little easier to connect with the community, we moved out to Higbee Avenue in our new offices. We've just been in them over a year.
Great. How are you liking those?
We love it.
That's wonderful.
It gives folks a little better chance to come see us if they want to.
Mm-hmm. Parking is available.
Yeah,
and, so forth.
And our volunteers love it because they come in quite often.
Let's talk about those volunteers. You've mentioned them a couple of times. I can tell how grateful you are for these good-hearted people. Wow, it takes a special person to volunteer for hospice, doesn't it?
It does, and we have them doing a variety of things. Some are involved in patient care, so if someone out there is interested, we have a very thorough training program we put folks through in order to do direct care with our patients. Sometimes that's reading, sometimes it's sitting with them, sometimes it's supporting the nurse or the aide that's there working with them. But we have lots of other opportunities for volunteers as well. We have them on our fundraising committees, fundraising events. We have a lot of support in the office. We have a pet program where we provide support for patients that have a dog or a cat or some other animal. You know, as their health declines, their ability to care for their animal declines as well. So the Stark Community Foundation has supported us in a grant that allows us to go into the home and walk the dog or take the cat to the groomer. And we have a number of volunteers involved in that and other volunteers that help us with veteran pinnings. We try to honor veterans every time we get one in our care. So we go to their bedside, wherever that is, thank them for their service, and then pin them on their lapel and salute them. It's usually retired military that do this. Invariably, I hear vets say, "Thank you, Noberry, thank me before for my service."
Wow.
So it's very powerful. Yeah.
Wow. So it does seem that there are certain qualities, or what do you find that someone that makes a good volunteer?
Well, compassion, sensitivity, being willing to give of themselves to the comfort of someone else. We have a lot of volunteers that come through us because they've had an end-of-life experience in their own family.
That's my guess.
And we've cared for their loved one, and, you know, we don't want them right away. They need to have that time of grieving. But once they're through that and feel they want to give back, they're welcome to come to our...
You often see that because you've benefited so much from it. You want to give back in some way to someone else going through that tough, tough time. Somehow they know. As you said, food is so important. I know in our own case, again, is with our family, with my mother on her last day. And somehow hospice knew that that must certainly be her last day. And they brought us lots of food so that we could continue to be with her. And that had never happened before. And I thought, how do they know? But I'd even heard that sometimes there's a scent or something. They can tell. They've been through this so many times before.
Sure.
They can just kind of tell when the person is about ready to just shed this earthly body and move on.
Yeah.
And, well, I guess we are so pretty much out of time. Anyway, Bob Phipps, thank you so much from Community Hospice. Let's give the website again for people.
Okay. It's www.myhospice, which is myhospice.org, and the 800 number, 800-947-7284.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for joining us on our community.
Thank you.